Okay, thank you everyone for being here. This is the Open Planetary Lunch Talk for May the 18th, 2021. I am Chase Million. Our speaker today is Benoît Sinovier. Did I get that right? Speaking on planning science opportunities with the JUICE Moon Coverage Tool. Thank you very much for being here and for giving this talk. Very excited about it. When you are ready, just go ahead and take over screen share.
Thank you, Chase. So I'm going to start the presentation right away. So as you said, I will present you the planning science opportunity tool that we are developing for the JUICE mission that will study the Jupiter system. So it's a collaborative work between the University of Nantes and the JUICE SOC team at ESAC. So we'll start by a short introduction on the JUICE mission for those who are not familiar with it. And after, I will move to a live demo of the tool. So if you have comments and if you want to interrupt me, feel free if you have questions. I will also paste in the chat the link to the notebook. So this presentation is actually a live notebook of the tool. So if you want to follow along and to review that later on, you can do it. So let's start. So as I mentioned, here are the few resources. So if you look at this presentation later on, you can go to these different links. I will not spend more time on that, but that's just for reference. So the JUICE mission stands for the Jupiter Icy Moon Explorer. It is an interplanetary spacecraft developed by the European Space Agency. It's an L-class mission selected in 2012 that will study the emergence of habitability environment of the three main moons of Jupiter. It's based in three main phases. There is a crew phase, flyby phase, and orbital phase. And it will carry 11 science instruments, Janus, which is a visible camera, MAGIS, which is a spectrograph, UVS, which is a UV spectrometer, SWI, which is a wave instrument, GALA, a laser altimeter, RIME, ice penetrating radar, GMAG, magnetometer, PEP is a particle mass spectrometer. RPWI is a set of radio and plasma sensors. 3GM, which are a set of tools in order to measure the gravity based on the radio telecommunication with the Earth, and PRIDE, which will try to do interferometry with the Huygens antenna. So as I say, the cruise phase will start in September 2022 with a launch with an Ariane 5. That's the latest launch date. It was delayed due to the COVID situation. And now the cruise phase is slightly different than what it was just a few months back. So now we will have one moon flyby, one Venus flyby, and two Earth flyby. And the orbit insertion at Jupiter will be in January 2031. And the cruise phase will have a duration of roughly 8.5 years. So in January 2031, when we will be at Jupiter, the mission will start by a series of flybys of the three main moons of Jupiter, Europa, Ganymede, and Callisto. We will have this phase will have a duration of 4 years, and we will have two flybys of Europa, 21 flybys of Callisto, and 12 flybys of Ganymede. And at the end of this phase, the spacecraft will be rerouted towards Ganymede, and in order to put it in a Ganymede orbital phase, so it will orbit around Ganymede in different stage. The first stage will be at 5,000 kilometers, so it's pretty much at high altitude. and in January 2035, and it will decrease its altitude down to 500 kilometers in May 2035. So the duration of the Ganymede phase is currently 1 year, and the end of the nominal mission is expected in October 2035. So for this mission, which is both a flyby mission and orbiter mission, we need very specific tools and especially to prepare the observations. And for that, we need first a tool to be able to evaluate the surface coverage and do a very quick visualization. So first at the trajectory level, in order to be able to identify where the trajectory will be, and also to be able to adjust the trajectory if needed. But we also need to have an idea of what will be the field of view of the different instruments in order to be able to visualize the coverage on the different moons that will be flyby. Another requirement from the SOC is the ability to locate when we have opportunities above certain areas on the surface. And especially the distribution of these opportunities based on the on pre-selected region of interest. And finally, we also need a tool which is able to compute and to filter these different opportunities, especially with observing geometry, like the attitude, the illumination conditions, and these kind of parameters, but also with operational constraints. Here you can see, for example, in orange, you have the representation of the local incidence at the intersection point on the surface of Ganymede for the Janus instruments. And we have a telecommunication window, so we have to change the nadir viewing of the spacecraft. And in some cases, the surface of is no longer visible when we are communicating with the Earth. And finally, the idea of this tool is to leverage as much as possible the already existing SPICE-based tools. It should be as much as possible generic. So it should work for JUICE, but it should also be able to work for other space mission in the future. We should be able to use it on different bodies, especially for the three main moons of Jupiter. It needs to be highly customizable with different kind of kernel set inputs, and for example, to be able to change very easily the background maps. We also want to have a tool which is as simple as possible for the user to use. We wanted to have a tool which is open source and developed in Python, and which which have the smallest number of dependencies in order to have something which is very easy to install on for the user. Because the end goal for this tool is to be able to have something which is very portable, which works in Jupyter notebooks, and as a standalone file, or even in the ESA data labs, which is a Jupyter lab instance, which that is currently developed by the SOC. So to address all these kind of things, we started to develop the JUICE Icy Moon coverage tool. It is a Python package which works with Python 3.6 and above. It's licensed with a BSD license, and it only requires NumPy, Matplotlib, and SpicyPy for its dependencies. It's currently funded by the ESA SOC, and it's developed at the University of Nantes since last year. It's already available on PyPy, and the documentation is available also on Read the Docs, and the current release is 0.8. And it was successfully deployed on the ESA Data Labs in order to get the first feedback from the JUICE team members. So to give you an idea, I will switch to the ESA Data Labs. So as a reminder, for now it's a beta version of the tool. It's more a proof of concept, but it already works. So it's very nice to show you how it works. So basically, it's as I say, it's a Jupyter Hub environment. So you can launch different kind of instances. So in our case, we will use the Juice instances. So I will start a new instances, and that instance will automatically start a Docker image which contains the tools, but also all the required kernels for the Juice mission. So you see, it takes only a few seconds to load, and you, as soon as it starts, you can see that the tool is already pre-installed for the user. I'm gonna just show you that it's already installed and the version is the latest version available. You can also see that the kernels are automatically mounted. So you have all your sets of kernels which are ready to be used by the user. So the idea is you just open a notebook and you can run the different cells. So here it's an example of that you can find also on the tool itself. So I'm switching back to my presentation. So to give you an idea of how the Moon coverage works, basically it's able to automatically search and find your kernels installed on your computer or in the case of the data lab directly installed on the data lab. But you also have a complete of the different CREMA, which are the name of the collection of the consolidated report on mission analysis metakernels that are provided by ESA in order to know the different kernel configuration that are required for the different kind of tool for the Juice mission. So to give you an idea, in that presentation, I will work with the metakernel 4.2, which is currently named as the backend launch in 2022, so in September, and that's the latest kernel available. So the tools works already with SpicyPy natively. So the idea is to be able to load very easily all the kernels, pre-configure everything that you need in order to jump directly to the calculation that you want. So in that case, I have selected the meta kernels that I mentioned before. I have selected the one which is only for the cruise part. And I have selected a target, which is the sun. And that give me that will load all the kernels in the background, and I can select a time range with a timestamps that will define my trajectory. So in that case, I have 12,000 points, almost 13,000 points, and I can use this trajectory directly in SpicyPy. So in that case, I'm computing the position of the spacecraft in the J2000 frame. With the reference to the solar system barycenter. So by doing so, I can represent here with Matplotlib in a 3D representation the actual trajectory for the cruise phase. So as you can see, it's a very efficient and very quick way to load a set of configuration and to represent that if you already know how to use SpicyPy. If you don't, or if you don't want to spend too much time on that, we also provide many helpers. So here I'm switching for a case with the Ganymede orbital phase. So I have selected my target, which is now Ganymede, and I have selected a one-day window during the orbital phase with a time step this time of 1 minute. And I can very quickly get the latitude and longitude, for example, of the subsolar points that will be my grand track trajectory, basically. So you can see that for 1,400 points, it only takes a few milliseconds to compute these parameters. And I will show you other examples later on. But here, for example, I can get the minimum of the altitude for that trajectory with very basic NumPy queries. And it takes just a few milliseconds to run. So to give you an idea of the different helpers that you can get for any kind of trajectory, here is the list. For example, we used before the ephemeric time, but you can also get the UTC time, the latitude and longitude, as I mentioned, the altitude, the distance, local time, incidence, emission phase, and so on and so forth. So you can refer to the documentation if you need more things. And it's integrated very well with Matplotlib. So now you can represent very quickly, for example, the evolution of the altitude as a function of time for the trajectory sequence that we selected before. And you can see that it only takes a few lines of code to represent this kind of things. The other thing that we wanted with that tool is to be able to make very quick selection in with a very simple syntax. So here you can see how you can, for example, take all the points where the trajectory is have an altitude below 500 kilometers, and you will have, in that case, a masked trajectory. And out of the 1,400 points initially, now you have only 900 points. So if I represent that now in the plot, you can see that we selected here in orange only the points which are below 500 kilometers. And these can be chained and with many different kind of queries. So you can have a multi-condition filtering. So now I can say I not only wanted to have the trajectory below 500 kilometers, but I also wanted to have the trajectory on the day side, so meaning that the incidence should be lower than 90 degrees. And you can see that now I have only 400 points in my trajectory. I can represent that again on my plot, and that's the part of the trajectory which meets this criteria. Another thing that the tool is able to do is to do mapping of this trajectory very easily. So you can import, for example, here the Ganymede base map. That is the default base map that we are using, but you can also provide your own if you want. And you can see that I can represent the same filtered trajectory, so below 500 kilometers and on the day side of Ganymede, directly on the map with just a few lines of code using basic Matplotlib projections. But you can go one step further. For example, you can say, I not only wanted to know where the trajectory is below 500 kilometers and on the day side, but I also wanted to know for this point, what is the actual incidence? So you can add another parameters in order to directly to color code the trajectory. So here we can clearly see that we only selected the value which are below 90 degrees. The second thing that the tool should be able to do is to be able to calculate the intersection between the trajectory and the different regions of interest. So for example, you can define your own region of interest if you want. So you just need to give them a key and define its contour. And from this region of interest, you can make Boolean comparison between, for example, trajectory and the ROI. And you can say, for example, you can ask if the trajectory is in the ROI. In that case, we actually do have an intersection between the two. And we can do the actual intersection with directly logical operators in Python. So here it's an intersection operator, and I can get again a masked trajectory in that case, which only contains 11 points. And when I represent that on the map, I can see that my trajectory intersects my region of interest only for these small sets of the trajectory. So as you can see, it's it should be as easy as possible in terms of syntax for the user to do complex calculations. Of course, you can define all your arrays by hand if you want, but we also provide already a couple of already known array for Ganymede and for Callisto that were defined by Catherine Stefan and collaborator in the PSS paper, which is currently under review. And for the case of Ganymede, we have 137 array which are already defined in different categories. So here I'm selecting the category, for example, 4 and the subcategory 2. And you have the list of the array that are in the paper. And you can select actually a specific array, and you will see not only its contour, but also additional parameters like a description and other parameters. So here is the full collection of all the arrays available for that are known on Ganymede, for example. And as we saw before, we can now do the intersection not only with one array, but also with a collection of array. So I'm taking the trajectory below 500 kilometers and on the day site, and I can compare that with the Ganymede array. And I can see that I have at least one array which is intersected by that trajectory. Again, I can take the intersection operator, and I can see all the arrays that are intersected. And I can represent that in the plot and showcase in red here all the arrays that are intersected with my criteria below 500 kilometers and on the day side. Finally, the tool is also able to search some advanced configuration, for example, for the flyby configuration. So in that case, I will search for all the flybys of the moons during the cruise phase. And you can see that you can query the list of the flyby. So the tool will automatically search for all the opportunities when the distance is below 100,000 kilometers to the center of the targeted body. And here you can see that we have two opportunities. The first one is actually the moon flyby that I mentioned before. And the second one is an Earth flyby, which is still a bit close to the moon. And you can represent that directly on the map. So here it's the representation of the two flyby as a function of the incident, color-coded for the incident. And finally, the tool is very recently able to represent directly the field of view of the instrument. So as I mentioned before, all the previous representation was only on the Juice spacecraft, but you can also provide a key for a specific instrument. So here I have selected a flyby of Ganymede with a specific sequence. So I will not go into detail, but the idea is you can provide a nonlinear sampling for the data. So in that case, I will sample my flyby with 1 point every 10 seconds for 10 minutes around the closest approach, and 1 point every minute for 1 hour around closest approach. So I'm selecting MAGIS, so it's the infrared spectrometer on JUICE, and I can get instrument flyby. And with that instrument flyby, I can represent directly the footprint of that flyby on the surface of Ganymede. So as a conclusion, the JUICE moon coverage tool is a very handy way to be able to access the kernels that are stored locally, or in that case in the data lab, and it provides also an easy access to the origin the JUICE CREMA metakernels configuration, and it can be used to load these kernels very easily. And to define, for example, temporary windows of interest. And after that, you can select only a subpart of the trajectory you are interested in. And at the end, you are able to just with a tensor line of code, basically you can represent a very complex intersection and orbital configuration. So for now, I only show you the equirectangular projection of the data, but we are working in order to add also other projection systems like stereographic and orthographic views. And we also wanted to implement a more advanced graphic user interface with buttons, sliders, and menus in order to even increase the interactivity for the user. So I would like to thank the SOC for their support and for the funding for the development of the Moon Coverage tool, and also the people on the data lab that allow us to deploy that very easily. As I mentioned, the current version available on PyPI is 0.8, and you have many examples that you can run on the tools. And if you want to have any feedbacks, you can already contact us with the email address below. So that's my last slide. Thank you.